Mormon Stories Podcast is a production of the Open Stories Foundation. All donations to Mormon Stories are fully tax deductible and go directly towards keeping the podcast alive and towards building a community of support for Mormons like you.
Come, come, ye saints, no toil nor labor fear, but with joy wend your way.
Hello and welcome, everyone, to another edition of Mormon Stories Podcast. I'm your host, John DeLynn. It is February 17th, 2016. We're downtown Salt Lake City and super excited for this interview. This is an interview I've wanted to do for years, and I cannot express how excited I am to have Tyler Glenn with us today on Mormon Stories. Tyler Glenn, welcome.
For years, eh?
Years.
Wow.
I've been waiting patiently.
Okay. Feel bad. I'm elusive.
For the three listeners who may not know who Tyler Glenn is, Tyler Glenn is the lead singer of the band Neon Trees. Rock band, pop band, depends on how you want to describe it. More rock than pop, what would you say?
Whatever, man. Yeah. Rocking and rolling.
But this is a world-class band, obviously, and we're going to be talking about a lot of cool stuff. We're going to be talking about Tyler's upbringing. Last year, was it? Tyler came out...
almost 2 now, yeah.
2 years ago. Almost 2. Tyler came out as gay, right as he was releasing his third album with Neon Trees.
Yeah.
Called Pop Psychology.
Yeah.
But he served a mission and was raised LDS. And so we're going to talk about his upbringing in the church. We're going to talk about, growing up sort of closeted gay in the church. We're going to talk about how his band formed and how he got big along with his band members. And we're going to talk about the process of coming to understand his identity and who he is and his sexuality. And we're going to talk about how that was to come out internationally in Rolling Stone magazine. And we'll probably end talking at least in part about some of the recent LDS church policies and his thoughts on that, his perspective on faith or secularism now, and maybe what might be in store for him in his life and artistically. What did I leave out?
I think that's exciting. I'm excited to talk about all this.
All right. Well, welcome again, Tyler. And I guess we should begin where we always begin by just talking about your upbringing. Temecula comes to mind. That's where you were raised, but is that where you were born?
Yeah, I was born in Poway, California. So I was raised Southern California kid. I guess that's where my voice comes from. But until I served the mission, then I was 21. So all of my life.
Were your parents converts to the church or?
Yeah, my dad converted. He was from Florida and then he moved to Vegas and he had friends in the church and started going to seminary. And I remember him getting involved, telling me about getting involved. Obviously, I wasn't alive. He got baptized when he was 18, went on a mission to it was called the Eastern States Mission. So kind of New York and Jersey. And my mom is from Broadbrook, Connecticut and Jersey area. And he baptized her and my brother, or my uncle, her brother.
Nice.
Yeah. So it was kind of like they weren't raised in any particular religion. And then all of a sudden... devout Mormons.
So no religious upbringing for your parents?
It was like Christian, or like they would go to like Methodist church or sort of kind of, you know, factions of Christianity. But
not deeply identified with any tradition.
No, I think they really identified with, they had an outlook on God and a belief in God, but I don't think, one prescribed to one religion.
Have they ever told you what sort of appealed to them about Mormonism, what it was? Was it the people? Was it a certain doctrine? Do you even know?
Well, my mom, I mean, we've talked over the years about it. My mom, I think followed my uncle's lead for a second and then really discovered the truthfulness of it. And, for her they talked about once they started having a family, how great it was to raise a family and just like, you know, but we were all in, like, that's all I knew. And, you know, I was a ride or die Mormon till, you know, most of my life, like, but that created some, we'll get into it. But,
so you have a few siblings. You're one of four, right?
I am one of four. Yeah. Yep. Three boys and one girl. So.
And you're in the order.
I'm kind of the middle kid, and then my sister came along, but so I guess I'm second
in line. So how traditional was your sort of Mormon upbringing? Pretty normal, like primary and.
Yeah. Like I remember that was like, we didn't miss a Sunday. Totally hardcore Mormon. I think we were like kind of an alternative family as far as like my mom raised us in a way where we were okay to be creative. I was a very creative kid early on and she took note of that. So like I wasn't good at sports, you know, big surprise, but I wasn't great at, and she wanted me to be like active. So she would put me in like, dance classes. So I was like a ballerina at age four, and that's cool until like you hit middle school and then that got hard. But
so you did it like 8 or 10 years?
I did it till I was like 12. So yeah, around then.
Okay.
But yeah, it was a big deal. I remember getting, you know, I actually remember my baptism day. I remember going to my first church dance when I was 14, like, you know, my mom was a seminary teacher for 11 years. So she, you know, I remember always having seminary kids over, at kind of crucial ages too, where I was very impressionable and it was nice to have like tons of Mormon teenagers over all the time. And I looked up to a lot of those kids and then we always had the missionaries over. We were kind of the, like, the Glen home was like the missionary like home, always on holidays, always like to call their parents, always for dinner. There was a moment where it felt like we always had missionaries over every day, like for a few years. I don't know if that had to do with because my older brother was preparing to go on a mission and my parents wanted that around, that influence, but I just remember most of my youth always having missionaries around. And
it has to be the missionaries brought them, missionary work brought them together. So they,
I think probably
that has to be just
the love for it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think
my dad like loved missionaries so much and so did my mother. But, I mean, my dad would come up to Salt Lake. I'm looking over cause it's Temple Square outside my window, but, he'd come to Salt Lake and like take missionaries out for lunch. And he was just that guy. Like, so that was always like the thing we were going to do is go serve a mission. But the thing is, I didn't ever feel like I was forced to, or like, but it just was something I wanted to do. That was the influence. And I looked up to my dad so much cause like I was in love with my mother and my dad found my mom, baptized her. It was just like kind of a love story. And it was very romantic, but very like spiritual and very like, it felt very like meant to be. And that was always something, you know, and as I started like, you know, battling with my sexuality and it was a battle. That was always a hard thing that there was a pressure because I didn't want to let my parents down. I looked up to them, you know, my brother, older brother went on a mission and he left when I was in eighth grade and came back when I was, so in 10th grade. And before I was like super into the church and and devoted. But then I discovered punk rock music and while he was gone. And
okay, wait. So just real quick. No, it's good. Because of the music background, I just have to ask, are there some favorite primary songs that you remember as like being the ones you love most?
I loved all church music. I really did. My favorite one, melody wise, was the "I Like to Look for Rainbows Whenever There's Rain." I just like that was really heartfelt. I wasn't probably more into the primary songs. I really liked hymns. Just at a young age, I loved hymns.
Any favorite hymns?
"Poor Wayfaring Man of Grief." I liked "If You Could Hide a Cola." Like, I loved that song. I think the melody is beautiful. You know, "Where Can I Turn for Peace? How Great Thou Art." Like, you know, probably the heavier ones.
Yeah, yeah.
Probably the heavier ones. But the most beautiful, I think, too.
Scripture study, family prayer, like family home evening.
Yeah. I think the influence of my mother being a seminary teacher was, you know, we just learned about church history. We learned about, scripture chase, that was just like part of it. It was always fun and I was never great at it, but it was like, you know, everything was related to the gospel and that was great. That was
fun. You identify with any prophets in the scriptures at all?
I didn't really. No, I didn't. My favorite, and I was Joseph Smith. Like, to me, like, the restoration made so much sense. And it used to feel like, before my mission, it seemed like it was like the cartoon story that you're kind of shown. But then, like, I definitely got a testimony on my mission about that, but we can get into that. But but yeah, I loved the idea that that happened, and it was exciting to me. And I have a vivid imagination. I'm a very creative person, always have been. So the possibility that like that God could speak to man was so exciting to me, and the possibility that like Joseph Smith saw a vision and then other visions and angels, and like that was amazing. And like I was like, this is so like so awesome, you know, because I believed in so much possibility. I always wondered about, you know, the universe and what was out there. So that was just like, you know, super important.
Did you feel like you tried to have a relationship with God as a child or as a, you know, teen? What was that like for you? Trying to communicate, trying to pray, trying to receive inspiration.
I vividly remember my teenage relationship with God. And it was really, really solid at points. And then really, really, looking back, I always felt like I was, when I wasn't maybe doing what I was thought I should be, or when I was wrestling with my sexuality, or, you know, experimenting with certain things that weren't in line with the church. And there was only a small portion of that in my youth, but I never felt like I was worthy to pray to God at that point. Like I took that very seriously, I guess, because I had such a belief in God. And so I felt like, I felt embarrassed, you know, I felt like, I don't know if it was a worthy thing. It was just sort of like, I knew that I wasn't doing what I should be. So I, you know.
How about that feeling of like unconditional love? Did you ever, was that an important part of your relationship with God?
Yeah, I think because I felt unconditionally loved by my actual parents. And so it just made sense. And like that was my view on God, is that he's a loving heavenly father. So like, I think because my parents are so amazing and put up with a lot but let me be me. And I think I thought of that with God. And I also felt like I would do that with my parents. I was always you know, I hated disappointing them, and there would be periods of time where I just wasn't very forthright with them or transparent, because I was, you know, doing things that I know they would already like not be stoked on. So it was kind of the same thing with God. Like, I know he knows what I'm doing right now, but like, I don't want to talk about it. I don't want to face it. And it really, I was a really good kid. I got into rock and roll, and I just found that as an outlet. So I was like, this is awesome. Like, I can express myself finally. And I was always searching for a way. So I started dressing really odd. But
you mentioned punk rock as an influence?
Punk rock music. The Smiths. Well,
who? Smith?
So the Smiths aren't really a punk band. But I remember, like, in seventh grade, there was this girl with a picture of Morrissey on her folder. And there was this group of Mexican kids. Growing up in Southern California, there were a lot of Latin kids. But there was a group of Mexican kids that wore tight jeans and, like, rolled their jeans up and, like, wore creepers and really influenced my style. But they were, like, these cool-looking pompadour Mexican kids. I was like, who are they? And who's this Morrissey guy? And why are they listening to the Smiths? And so I just got really into the Smiths. And then Morrissey was a big fan of the New York Dolls. And the New York Dolls were just like this, like, loud, like, you know, interesting. They dressed really out there. And for a closeted queer kid, that was like, oh, cool. Like, they're pushing the envelope, but they're not addressing their sexuality. And David Bowie. And
now the New York Dolls lead singer had not converted to Mormonism.
He hadn't yet. Okay. I mean, that was amazing. Are you kidding me? He was like a hero of mine.
What was his name?
Killer Kane. Yeah, Arthur, right, Killer Kane. Right, yeah. Right. Insane. I mean, that movie was
a good movie. It's called New York Dolls.
New York Dolls. Yeah.
Okay. So that was your major punk influence, was the New York Dolls?
I think New York Dolls, and then I got into like California pop punk and growing up in that. And then I got really into like local shows and kind of became a scene kid. And me and my girlfriend in high school, we would just like, that was our life. We would go to shows. And
did you say a scene kid?
Yeah, I was like a scene, like.
Like, go to the shows all the time.
Yeah, and then it was before emo music, if anyone knows what. So it wasn't like I had like the swooped hair and like dressed in all black, but we were just kooky and we were really into Japanese culture too. So we like would dress really, really outlandish. And that was just like,
would you go to thrift stores to buy your clothes?
Oh yeah. But that was when thrift stores were cool. Like, they're not great anymore. They're pretty picked over. Savers and Orem is still.
So are we talking like Mohawks or chains or leather?
I looked like a mix between like Edward Scissorhands and like Robert Smith. Like, my hair was just like outlandish.
Now, weren't the Smiths before your time?
Oh yeah. Yeah. Okay.
So you were kind of retro. And they were only around
for 6 years.
Yeah.
But that's just what spoke to me. I liked modern music, but it was a little, there's just something I saw myself in a lot of those artists, and it just spoke to me in that way. I think maybe there was like a more open-mindedness. There was an artistic, there was like a sexual ambiguity to a lot of those artists that I think I clung to, because they never had to really address their sexuality. They were able to just be. And I always wanted that. I've always craved that, to just be able to not have to talk too much about that. And they made they were characters, and they could hide in that. That was
so,
really cool.
So New York Doll, Smiths, Morrissey, you said David Bowie.
David Bowie, you know, Freddie Mercury, Mick Jagger.
You were digging all those.
Steven Tyler. But I was just like, those are like the big like rock. I loved like the cool rock stars. And I just, but I got huge into Depeche Mode and The Cure. I went through a pretty like industrial goth phase. But I, all the while being super active Mormon and not, I didn't get into like real shenanigans till I was like 17. And that was really, I remember it pretty clearly. Like, the bishop told me I wasn't allowed to bless the sacrament because of the way I looked.
Because you'd wear this to church.
I wasn't, but I dressed like I wore a tie, and I wore a white, I always wore a white shirt, and I always wore, you know, slacks, but I think I couldn't really comb my hair down.
Because you had big hair.
I had pretty big hair. And, you know, I would wear like a cool like blazer or something. Like it was definitely like, you know, I liked, you know, it was a cool place to dress up, church. But I was always respectful, I think. But I think it got to the point where like he said I was a distraction.
Did you ever get to bless the sacrament?
Yeah, a lot.
Okay.
So that's what was weird.
So you passed, you were deacon, teacher, priest, all that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
At Bishop, some point.
Bishop Haldeman was like kind of a very, very much a very conservative guy. And I think it just got to the point he might have gotten complaints. I have no idea. But my dad, it really fired up my dad because my dad's like, he's worthy. He's a good kid. Like, he was very defensive of me. And that, it was sad because that same weekend, I remember my friends who were able to bless sacrament were doing some things that were clearly not, you know, with girls. And I remember seeing it and I was just like, that was the first taste of like, all right, there's some hypocrisy going on here. Cause I know I'm a good kid. God knows I'm a good kid. I've never tasted alcohol. I've never done drugs. I've never, you know, had sex. I'm a good, clean kid. Like, what's going on? You know? And so.
What was that? How did that feel when he pulls you into his office and says,
I don't even think it was a matter of him pulling me off. I think I went up to go do it like I usually did. And it was, he asked me to not.
Oh.
Yeah. It wasn't great. And so then from that point on, I was like, you know what? I've always had questions about some of this stuff. And that's kind of when I drank with friends and kind of experimented with certain things. And that was a very dark time in my life too. And I felt like I didn't know where I was going, but I was like, I want to be a musician. But I'm really afraid to get into that. Cause like, I like, you know, having fun and that was weird. And I felt very, I always felt like I was just like disappointing God, disappointing my parents, not living the way I should be. And then I graduated high school and I remember the time was to come to prepare to serve a mission or, you know, go to college. And so that summer after high school, I was really big into Bruce Springsteen because it was right around 9/11. And he had just released an album called The Rising. And it just spoke to me on a very spiritual level, that record. And
I think of him as such a blue collar kind of
he's
white guy. You know what I mean?
He brings the spirit, man.
Yeah.
He just hits your soul. Yeah. And I got huge into Bruce Springsteen and I got all his records and I only listened to Bruce Springsteen records that summer. And I
That's so reading. Not punk rock.
And I know. I'm not punk rock. I just liked, you know, I'm not.
But it's just like so not new wave. It's not. But that's cool.
It was kind of like a secret I kept too, because it wasn't very cool.
You're closeted.
Yeah. But I was obsessed. And then I remember, so I was listening to Bruce Springsteen records and I decided to read the Book of Mormon again. Like I had read it, but like, I don't think it ever had sunk in. And I was like, all right, I have to decide if I'm going to go on a mission or not. Cause it was like, I thought I did. And then, you know, I became kind of like a wild teenager, not crazy. I was still a really good kid, but like, you know, I had to make a decision. And all the while I was also, dealing with being gay, and that was coming. I'd never experimented with my sexuality. I'd never been with a guy. And I'd never really entertained it. It was more like emotional connections to guys. Like I would have crushes on friends and things like that. And that was always difficult.
I think I read you knew 6 or 7 years old.
Yeah.
That's pretty early.
Yeah. There was stuff that went on, but I don't know. There was a little bit of like abuse that happened at one point. I won't get too deep into that, but I think I was exposed to sexuality early. And then it was and then that abruptly stopped. So it was a very like quick moment. I think I was like around 6 or 7. And, but I remember even before that, like having crushes on boys in class and showing my mom or my friends like, yeah, this boy's cute, blah, blah, blah. And like, she being like, whatever, like not really reading too much into it.
One of the stereotypes is that abuse causes same-sex sexuality.
Yeah. And it didn't for me. I don't subscribe to that idea. I don't think that's even possible, but.
So there's no connection?
No, not at all. I think in a way that's what made the abuse less sinister, because it was like, I felt, I don't know. It was kind of like, it definitely was deep. It was weird for sure. But I and then I never really, I soon found that it was something I had to hide, because like, you know, in the 90s, especially growing up, it wasn't cool. And it definitely wasn't something you wanted to be, you know what I mean?
In the research we've done, there's a difference between the age that the kids realize they're different. That's usually around 8 or 9, let's just say. But then the age where they actually say, whoa, I'm attracted, same-sex attracted. And that's often around 13.
I think I thought I was gay. And then I thought maybe I was just, it was complicated because, like I said, I looked up to artists like David Bowie and Morrissey, and sort of sexually ambiguity was a big thing for me. And I always thought like, oh, maybe I don't have to like claim anything. And I loved the idea that it was no one's business. I really clung to that. Like when I would hear people say like, it's not, I would love that. Now I don't feel that way. I think yes, it's no one's business, but I think it's important to like live your truth and be open. But at the time I clung to that idea of like, oh, I can just like kind of hide in it. So it wasn't something I would always face. You know, I would have conversations with myself for sure. And it wasn't until like 18 that I had conversations with God about sexuality.
So was there a point where internally you sort of said, yep, I'm gay?
Yeah. Yeah. I think definitely my mission.
It was later.
Yeah, it wasn't. Because I dated a girl. I thought, I always clung to the idea that like being gay was a challenge that you overcame. I kind of liked that concept. I was like, all right, I can do this. Which sounds really bizarre, but it was like, I just figured, yeah, that makes sense. It's something I need to overcome, like any sort of challenge that someone's given in life.
Do you remember where that idea got introduced to you? Was it?
I mean, definitely at church. I think, I distinctly remember For Young Men Only, that pamphlet. And I remember it, and I reread it recently, but it's crazy that it still is in there. But Spencer W. Kimball, right? Or as a Tef Benson, is one of those prophets, and they kind of explicitly say how wrong homosexuality is, and how masturbation leads to homosexuality. And I remember distinctly reading, there was a paragraph where he says like, if any guy came up to me, I'm paraphrasing completely.
This is Packer, I think.
Packer.
Yeah.
If any guy came up to me and tried to do something physical with me, I'd punch him, you know? And that was always like, all right, like clearly I'm not going to talk about this publicly, you know? And then I think what I knew love and attraction to be at the time as a teenager, my girlfriend filled that, you know, it was teenage love. I was in high school.
So you guys would kiss and hold hands.
Kiss. Yeah. You know, it was a normal thing, normal relationship.
No aversion on your part. So just.
No.
Maybe not the deep attraction.
It wasn't the deep, I guess it wasn't deep. It's what I knew at the time. It's what I knew love to be. You know, I think it's, I don't think it was, I love that girl. She's one of my best friends still, which is really cool. But like but I really understand more, and I became to understand more later, like what real real love and real attraction and real passion is, for sure.
Okay.
What that feels like.
So at the time you were just having a girlfriend and living the gospel.
Living the gospel and then working to overcome. Yeah. And then, I was still active. I still went to seminary every morning. I ended up not graduating seminary because senior year was sort of the year that I started to like get really bad grades and experiment with things and sort of not care. And I tried to do a lot of the makeups, but I think I had 180 makeups. My mom was still a seminary teacher at the time.
That must have been hard for her.
She didn't love it, but I think she was also like, I don't know. Yeah. I don't know if it was like she was embarrassed. I don't think so. But yeah, like everyone had graduated seminary. But I was also the kid that like almost got my Eagle Scout, but just never did kind of thing. Cause it just, my heart wasn't in it. So I think it wasn't a huge blow. Like I wasn't my older brother was the kid that like served them like kind of the golden LDS youth.
Some of the music that you've listened to that you mentioned in your youth kind of has an anti-establishment vibe. Did you have a little bit of that?
Yeah. And that
just
was
kind of
a
fight
battle.
The power, fight the man.
Yeah. And that's what I looked up about my mom too. Cause my mom sort of had that, but in a very like, it was definitely watered down. It never was against anything relating to church or church values, but she would question and she raised us to question and like find out and she was passionate about things when like certain things would come up politically, but like, you know, but so I looked up to her as a role model in that way, but I definitely had more of that spirit. And yeah.
Just real quickly, were you trained on any musical instrument? Were you trained in terms of as a vocalist? Like, when did the music start picking up?
I was never trained. I would sing in church a lot. I would get asked to sing in church a lot. I was always in worship.
Like Janis Cat Perry songs or?
It was Janis Cat Perry. It was some Afterglow. Remember Afterglow? I loved Afterglow. Michael McLean. I think some of those. And then like hymns as well. But I loved that music. I loved EFY music. I'd never gone to EFY. We were Californians. I never had gone to EFY. But I loved EFY tapes. I loved the seminary soundtracks too. Like I remember listening to like those tapes on repeat. I don't know why. Because my mom got them. So.
Was there a song or two that you loved to perform in sacrament meeting that you remember?
Again, I think it was the hymns.
Okay, just the hymns.
Yeah, I don't. I know that I sang other songs, yeah, but I don't specifically remember.
Okay, so you sang in sacrament meeting a lot.
And then in ward choir, and I was, you know, I was always getting the solos. They're always... So I was like, all right. And my parents saw that I had talent.
Tenor or bass?
I was a tenor. I had a pretty high range. And then I was also in like local community plays too, like that weren't LDS affiliated, but that actually got us going to other churches sometimes, like on Sunday, not on Sundays, but like I remember going to a lot of different churches just to do performances or things like that. Our best family friends were Catholic and that was never an issue that we were Mormon. And so I remember going to like vacation Bible school because my mom was like, hey, the Butchers was a family that went to a Lutheran thing. And they're like, hey, you know, we should learn about God and Jesus over summer. So I remember like, I was like 5 or 6 and going to like a Christian Bible camp for a week. So it was like, it was always religious. And then, but I think the Mormon church is always just the conduit to Christ. That's how we viewed it. So I don't see it. I can see now looking back, maybe that was like is that a conflict to go to awesome. Be young and going to another?
I don't think so. I mean, it's maybe a little bit different.
It never was for me. Yeah.
For me, it's so fun to think about, like I'm a big Sam Cooke fan. He got his musical start singing in the church, Whitney Houston.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And that's kind of true for you. Like
your
musical roots are very much Mormon.
Talent shows, like road shows. I wrote a song for the road show and like did a whole
Do you remember what it was about?
Well, so I did it to the music of What's My Age Again by Blink-182. It's like a Blink-182 song. But I did it related to
Do you remember the song? Topic.
I don't, but we do have it on video. I should find it. That'd be YouTube. Amazing. Yeah. But I loved it because it was like, I remember specifically being able to bring the spirit to meetings and bring this. I knew I had that talent. And so I loved it. I loved hearing people, like, I loved seeing people's reactions. And I knew that it was of God. And I knew that that was a talent given to me. And I always felt super special and blessed that I had a talent. And so when I discovered rock, I never thought about being in a band, because I didn't know if that was like something you could do. Because again, like artists and bands for me until about like high school, they were always like, Michael Jackson was another huge influence. I'm sorry that I even left him out because he was like a superhero to me, but they were always so otherworldly. So I loved being able to sing in church and doing like plays and stuff, but like it was never an idea to like make it a career until I realized, oh, I could do that. All right, I could try.
So no piano playing or guitar playing growing up?
No, I would get on pianos or guitars and kind of like strum, and eventually learn like little basic chords, but I've never been like formally trained in anything.
It kind of blows me away. Like when I interviewed Clark Johnson, the Book of Mormon musical guy,
yeah,
he didn't do musical theater growing up.
Yeah.
And you didn't really do...
I didn't do anything
rock band
formally
stuff.
Yeah.
You weren't in a band in
high... I was in a high school band.
Okay.
But I was like the lead singer, like showboat guy, you know. I didn't have any...
And were you into the band?
I would pick up the guitar live and then like maybe even have it strapped on, but like I was just such a performer all the time, and that was my outlet, and I loved it. So like I just would end up breaking things or breaking the guitar or breaking the keyboard, so I just eventually just went.
How long were you in the band?
It was like a really bad garage punk band till I was 18. And then I met Chris Allen, Neon Trees' guitar player. He lived around the corner from me. And the Allens, his family, were another like big Ward family. Like, you know, we were the Glenn family. We sat in the third pew from the front. And then the Allens sat behind us. So it was like, I always knew Chris, but he was a little older than me. So like, I wasn't friends with him, but then I got introduced to him because my dad was like kind of worried about me, but he knew I liked music and he knew Chris Allen liked music. So he's like, you should hang out with Chris and you guys both like music. And I remember going over to his house and feeling really awkward, but then he gave me a tape and he was like, hey, you know, I've been writing music for a long time and these are the instrumentals and maybe you can write some lyrics to it. And I remember going home and then coming back, he thought it was going to take a few weeks. And I came back, like, I think it was either the next day or that evening, and like came with like three songs written and they were like pretty good. And he was like super impressed. And so then we started a group called Neon Trees.
And he plays the...
He's a guitar player.
He's just a normal guitar
Chris
player.
Chris Allen.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So this is just curiosity. So yeah. Band you were in before being with Chris, how long were you in it?
We started probably in ninth or 10th grade, and I was through high school.
Was it a really serious thing? Like the band was like really...
I thought of it as like, but I knew it wasn't, I don't think it was good enough, but it was with like, you know, high school friends, and we did take it seriously, but there were other band, like there was a lot of bands that went to our school, like, and they, a couple of them went on to be successful for a minute. I don't think anything currently, but so that was always like, oh, it's possible, like these guys, you know, got signed, so why can't we? So it was always like an idea and a hope.
So like
high school talent shows,
battle of the bands kind of
talent
stuff.
Shows, and then we would do shows like regionally at venues.
Okay.
So it was cool. It was a taste, but it wasn't ever what the type of music I wanted to make. A music that sounded like that had a danceable element, and that was kind of dance poppy. And so Chris and I started doing like acoustic shows because it was just me and him. And it was kind of about the same time I decided I was going to serve a mission. So we called it Neon Trees. And
did the name come from anything specific?
Yeah. So me and my friends, I think there was some sort of marijuana involved at that time, because I think it was 17. I was hanging out with my friends. We were at In-N-Out Burger.
Nice.
Which is like, it was kind of like, for Saved by the Bell fans, that like show is kind of like our max, like the max was like kind of the diner place you'd hang. And this was an early one, an early In and Out. And so they had these neon palm tree lights, and me and my bands made a fake band called the Neon Trees. Oh, I think we were called the Neon Palm Trees. And we like went to one of those photo booths and like did like a band photo and like made up a fake flyer and like made a fake album. But like, so that was always a name I thought was cool. And I had a list of names, band names, and Chris liked Neon Palm Trees the best, but I was like, that's a little much. So let's just call it Neon Trees. So essentially we're named after a fast food restaurant, which is kind of annoying, but it's a good, it's probably my favorite fast food restaurant.
And so you guys started performing as Neon Trees.
Yeah, but it was like we'd play friends' parties. I remember we'd play some coffee shops because it was acoustic. So it sounds like nothing like Neon Trees.
Just one guitar?
Just him. He was an amazing guitar player. Like it almost like when we started to become a full band, like his talent didn't shine as much because he was so lyrical with the way he played. Okay. And that was the thing. I knew I needed to be in a band with Chris, but I also knew I wanted to serve a mission. So it was like, crap. And so we decided like, let's start Neon Trees when you get back from your mission, and we'll do it.
So you read the Book of Mormon.
I read the Book of
Mormon.
And
did it give you an answer?
Yeah. Like immediately it became clear that the restoration wasn't the Disney movie version that I thought it was. It was a real thing that happened. It immediately came clear and made sense to me that Christ would talk to, if he's talking to people in biblical areas, why isn't he talking to other people around the world? All of that made sense to me, like, and I loved it, and probably because I was raised in it, and that was probably another thing. But like, it definitely, I felt a confirmation. I felt like I had really worked on my relationship with God at that point, so I felt like I was definitely getting a spiritual witness that it was true. And I remember telling my parents, and they were kind of surprised that I was going. And then it kind of just like, I fell in line. I remember cutting my hair, and that was like a big deal. That was like that. And I had no idea how to style it normal, which was really lame. And then I remember,
that's so much of your identity by that point, to chop off that hair.
It was a bummer. And that was a hard thing. And
but it sounds so lame just to admit that, right? Like,
oh yeah.
I mean, oh, my hair, you know what I mean?
Like, oh yeah. No, it was my, I want to,
from a Mormon point of view, I mean.
Yeah, no, but I want to express like my physical identity and the way I was able to express myself through clothes and hair and music. That was like the only way I was getting what I was dealing with inside out. And so to assimilate and to sort of put on the white shirt and the tag and the tie, that was hard. And so I definitely like would have flair. Like I definitely would push the boundaries with colorful ties, or like I still find ways, or put stickers on the back of my tag or things like that to sort of just like still hold on a little bit. But I also had respect because I loved the missionaries. And I had so much respect for the calling, and I had so much respect for my father baptizing my mom and them being converted, and my older brother who I looked up to at that point. So it was definitely like, I didn't disrespect my mission, but it was just like finding a way to like still express myself was, you know, was part of it.
And did you go through that for some very typical adolescent gay religious experience of pleading with God to take this away, like, can you heal me of this, or bargaining or promising, or was it not pronounced enough at that point?
I don't know if it was pronounced until much later, but it was definitely, I remember negotiating a lot with God, and I remember I was super, like, if I had read the Book of Mormon, or if I was reading the scriptures, or if I was praying, then I felt like that was sort of the way I was negotiating, like almost bartering, which is kind of odd, but I was kind of like, And I remember, I think probably because I was so focused on making music with Chris and being really excited about the adventure I was about to go on. And I looked at it that way too. I looked at the mission as sort of like a coming of age experience too. So that was, I was excited about that. So I think I just had enough distraction where it felt like I wasn't really preoccupied with sex, and that was nice. And I didn't have to think about it. And
that's kind of nice.
And I wasn't sexually active. So it was like, it wasn't something like I had to turn off physically all of a sudden. So I didn't know what it was like. So yeah.
The genie wasn't out of the bottle
yet. The genie wasn't out yet.
Yeah. But the typical kind of guilt with masturbation kind of stuff.
Oh yeah. Yeah. The little factory was definitely like a phrase I always saw, like and I always lied in my bishop interviews too. Like, I don't think I was like a crazy masturbator growing up, but like, that was definitely something I didn't like talking about. So I wouldn't bring it up a lot as a teenager.
And as a total side note, this theme about learning to lie young for the church, sometimes that really impacts people. Do you feel like it impacted you?
Absolutely. Because I actually was, I became very dishonest in a lot of things I did. I went through a period of stealing, like my friends and I, you know, and I remember being caught a couple times and then finally being caught from stealing money from my parents' drawer or something. The amount of shame I felt, and I remember going to Bishop Brimhall and having to talk to him, and it felt therapeutic, but like I really had to deal with, like, I think lying was definitely a thing that I had to deal with. And I, looking back, yeah, it had to do everything with my identity. Like, I always had to sort of create a version of myself, you know? So lying, storytelling became kind of an easy thing to do. And then when I really felt like therapy helps, but I think I unwired that, and now I'm like overly honest and have no filter, which is kind of funny now. It's like the complete opposite.
Yeah.
But
so your mission.
Yeah.
What do you want to say about it?
I loved it. I went on to Omaha, Nebraska. Nebraska was my favorite Bruce Springsteen record. So that was the only thing I knew about Omaha, Nebraska. I kind of thought Omaha was short for Oklahoma. So it was very vague, like what that whole Midwest area. I was kind of let down that I didn't go to Japan, because I had been an exchange student in Japan. I left that out, but for sixth grade. And so I just always thought like, oh, I have a reverence for the culture. I'll go to Japan, but I ended up going to Nebraska. So that's funny. But I loved it, man. There was definitely a struggle with homesickness for the first couple months, and just kind of settling into the routine and the lifestyle. But it became clear to me that these 2 years had purpose. It became really clear to me when I sort of was able to stand up straight and talk to people, because as a teenager, I was very shy, very like, and I still work on how I'm not great at enunciating, but, you know, I was very like, very, very quiet and introverted. And that was something like, I always really, you know, I felt like I had the spirit. I had the mantle. I was able to express myself, through the spirit. It was exciting. I was able to like teach. Soften hearts. I witnessed those things. I would get in trouble a little now and then for talking about past transgressions, but that was the method of teaching that I thought was appropriate. It was right around Preach My Gospel. I think it had come out while I was in the MTC. Like, it was sort of like the first week wasn't, and then they're like, well, we're transferring over to this now. And that was exciting because I felt like this is going to serve my teaching style. This is going to serve how I want to tell stories about who I am and where I come from. And because I thought that was important for people to realize, like, I'm not just some like cookie cutter kid that is riding a bike, you know, to your house and teaching you about God. I would carry my senior photo. My senior photo is ridiculous. Like, I have hair out to here. I won best hair. I look insane, but I would carry that and I'd say, this, you know, this was me. I got discouraged from doing that eventually. You know,
there's something weird about that. As I think back, because, bizarre. Well, only just because you're basically saying, look how, I don't know if this is what you were saying, but it's like, look what I was, but now look at me, I'm clean cut. But you, there's probably a part of you that loved that part of you, right?
I did. It wasn't more about that. It was more like I wanted to let them know that I wasn't just a kid from Utah that didn't know anything.
Okay.
And I wanted to be able to like, I wanted people to be able to get to know me personally. I never revealed my first name. I wouldn't go that far, but like, I definitely felt like I can be as authentic as possible because this is the truth and they need to know it. And God would want me to be authentic. Like, I know how to get to these people's hearts. I feel like I can do that. And now having the Spirit, and I feel like it's, you know, I'm going to be able to really touch people and preach the gospel. And so, I had a successful mission. I feel like I baptized families and it was cool. And I don't know. I learned a lot about because I hated people. My biggest fear were people. People made me anxious. I didn't trust people. And then I really, really became really passionate and fell in love with people. And like, that was a big part of, you know, big lesson on my mission, that I was able to like really genuinely love people. That was a big reveal for me too. So I loved my mission, you know. I even said up until a few months ago, I would say that was my, other than like, if I hadn't ever been successful in a band, that would have probably been my two favorite years. And I hated that I did say that, because that's like a cliche thing to say, the best 2 years, but like, I loved it. I made some friendships that are still meaningful to me. Like, so it was a big thing, and it made sense. Like, I loved the idea that you go at 19 and like, it all made sense to me. Like, those are very like important years. And I knew like, I also kind of knew I didn't want to go to college, and I wanted to be in a band, and I felt like it gave me time to like kind of just focus on all that. It was really cool too. Like, I didn't feel like I had any temptation to sin, because it was such a regimented lifestyle. So that was
never like, attracted to your companions significant way.
That came. I did fall in love, not with companions, but there were two elders that I definitely felt a deep connection to. But again, it wasn't really sexual, because that was never something that I explored prior. So. But that didn't turn off. But I also felt like, since it wasn't overtly sexual, that maybe it was just like, oh, these are, you know, these are friendships. This is what it feels like to like have a real connection with somebody, or in that way. But as far as like, I didn't have, you know, there was no time to sin. So that was nice. Like, it was a very like, it was a break. It was sort of a break. Like, I was able to press pause as well. And maybe looking back, maybe it was like a, you know, I love, like, going back to like loving David Bowie, like his, how he was a chameleon and able to change and create different characters. I thought maybe like, though, this is like, maybe this mission is like a part of my story. You know, it's adding to who I am. It's giving me depth, and it's true. So that's a bonus. So
do you think your mission president ever saw something special in you?
Yeah, I kind of became known as, there was a period of time, I think he let me get away with a little more because I was, he let me kind of wear the loud ties and he would still make me his own leader. He let me sort of maybe not always have the part in my hair, but it was a little shorter, you know. I was always performing at you know, zone conference and mission conferences. And they would let me play the guitar at zone conference. That was really cool. I think my mission president, you know, I don't know, but like, I felt like he was inspired. I remember going my farewell interview or whatever. Like, I don't know what that's technically called. Like when you're going home and you have your interview with your mission president. And I know that everyone else in the district that was going home, you know, said that he told them to get married and he told me specifically to wait to get married and to pursue my musical dreams. Cause I was vocal about, I want to start a band when I get home. Like, this is what it's called. I remember writing it on couches in mission apartments, like neon trees. And on P days, I recorded music on a 4-track. Like, I have 2 albums worth
of tape.
It was a tape, and then a member in the ward was able to convert to a CD, and I remember making a few copies, and there's a few missionaries that still have. But I would write about my mission experiences, so I felt like, it was all still in line. And
you knew a few chords then on the guitar?
Yeah, it was more like I would just tune it till it sounded good, and, you know, it's really,
so
it's not.
So play by ear kind of thing?
You're pretty play by ear. Yeah.
Okay.
I'm not musically trained, like I said.
Kind of a tangential question. Did you carry this sort of like fear that people thought you were gay or that people wondered or do you think that people pretty much said, oh, he's gay?
I think people would think I was gay until I told them I wasn't, or would say, no, I'm just into music. I'm an artistic guy. Or like, and I think when people got to know who I was, then they were like, oh, he's just like cool or like unique or whatever. Like, and I kind of developed like a raspier, deeper voice as a teenager. So I think so for sure. Cause high school was rough as far as like always being called, you know, pretty explicit.
You were called names?
Yeah. But I always kind of was like, yeah, it's probably because I wear like tight pants or I'm kind of like, you know, punk rock, goth, artistic looking guy. So, you know, and I hang out with drama kids and art kids. So it's like, I'm like, oh, they're probably just assuming that. And like, and it going back to like, I never really like took ownership of my sexuality or claimed anything. So it's kind of like, I liked the vagueness and I liked being able to defy expectation or defy preconceived notions. So like, I don't know.
Yeah.
You know, I was able to hide in a way, in that way.
So when you would tell missionaries, no, I'm not, or whatever.
Yeah.
Did you think of it as lying?
Interesting. No, I think it's always been about survival for me. So, and I think I definitely felt like that was okay. Cause that was, I knew it was something that I didn't really want to, I never wanted to come out. I never wanted it to be like a thing that I had to really face. And as an 18, 19, 20 year old, like not sexually active, like that was easy to do. It was like, I can hide this or I can keep this.
It can just be like, that's not going to be a part of my life.
So it's not going to be a part of my life. Yeah. Yeah.
So I'm not going to own it. I'm not going to claim it.
Yeah. And
not even necessarily lying then.
It never felt, I guess that never felt like lying. Yeah. Is that bizarre? I don't know, man.
No.
And I'm thinking about
what
that.
It is.
Yeah, it is.
So you told a really great story, really powerful story at the Equality Utah banquet.
Yeah.
From your mission. Do you feel comfortable telling that story?
Yeah.
And are there any other stories that are really important?
There were a few. There was one that I remember pretty vividly being an elder kind of would confide in me. I was his zone leader. I think it was his zone leader. And so I would do nightly calls with him. And And I think he felt comfortable with me. And we slowly got to the point where we confided in each other without saying anything specifically. And he said more than I was willing to confess or to say about his sexuality. But that was something that I think he definitely faced. And I remember hearing after his mission, him sort of trying to make it work. I think he had girlfriends. He might've had a wife for a short period of time. Hearing that he maybe wasn't really active and then hearing that he wasn't alive anymore. And that was a bummer. And, I definitely felt, I don't know if I felt responsible, but I definitely felt like, man, this is not great. Like this is obviously something, there's something to this because he didn't make it. Like I thought I was able to turn it off and it was easy. And I look back at that sometimes and wish that maybe I had been more of a support system, but I just wasn't able to.
You wish, what do you wish you would have said?
Wish I was more transparent. I wish that I had been able to say like even simple things like you're not the only one or and I think I was too vague. And I definitely feel like that and then other things throughout my 20s definitely helped me to like, you know, get more confident with that. But
so you felt a little guilty maybe a little responsible?
I think there was a level of responsibility for sure. There is definitely sadness. Yeah, it was definitely a bummer.
Okay. Anything else really formative or important from your mission or? I saw you had 15 or 17 baptisms or whatever.
Yeah, like
success.
Yeah.
Some families.
I remember specifically there was this big motorcycle guy, like Harley guy. And we had been teaching him for a few months. His name is Rex. And I just felt I felt like a parent for the first time because I cared about this man so much, but he was like this big, tough, you know, burly motorcycle guy. And to see the tears that would come out of his eyes when he would talk about God or the spirit or to see the like, the change in his countenance and this, you know, the shame that he felt for the life he had led up until then. And we had set a date for his baptism. And and I remember him not, everyone was there. excuse me. The ward was there. It was all arranged. It was exciting. And then Rex didn't show up. And that was I think that was the first time I could see how my parents felt like when I maybe was going through like some stuff as a teenager, just like, I felt such compassion and I felt like I was searching for a missing kid. I was like, where's Rex? Like we have to find him. And I remember just feeling that distinct, like we lost him. Damn it. Like he was so close. And I maybe saw him once or twice, before I was transferred out of that area. But that was distinctly like painful and hard because I saw his transformation and I I saw what the gospel was going to do for his life. And that was tough. So that was a big moment.
Did he say why he didn't show?
I don't think we ever got like a concrete answer. I think, you know, from that point on, it was a lot of like not eye contact. And I don't know if he had been, there was another woman I remember that she was very close, Sharon, and she had gotten sort of anti'd. And so that was another, I guess that's another thing that I was very always aware that there was like anti-Mormon literature out there. And I saw it affect her. And I remember us going to her church with her to show sort of as not as a peace offering, but sort of like, you know, we'll go with you and we'll see what you're learning. And I could tell she had been anti'd pretty heavily with.
Is that a verb, anti'd?
Antide. Yeah, you ever heard that?
No.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
That's definitely a mission term, or maybe it's a California LDS term. She'd been antide for sure, though. I definitely remember my go-to was always the First Vision movie, the restoration video. I really liked showing Lamb of God as well, that film, because I think it just like, it definitely brought the spirit and made it very clear what we were talking about. But I love teaching the restoration. The things that, and I love teaching families can be together forever and all that. I wouldn't drive home the word of wisdom as much. That obviously was like a requirement, but that was something that I felt. I always felt like if they knew the truthfulness and they felt the spirit and the spirit could be brought, then like it would be easy. And I saw it too. I saw a numerous people, you know, give that stuff up pretty quickly. So that was never a focus of mine, you know. And that was exciting. I mean, Preach My Gospel is a cool thing that the church brought into mission work, I think. Like it, you know, I don't know what it is like now. I don't know if that's still the same vibe, but I thought it was cool. I thought it kept an openness. And my brother, my older brother had served years prior. And, you know, I remember him telling, and my dad as well, telling me like they had to learn and memorize. And I just felt like it was like, I went at the mission, on my mission at the right time. Like, it was definitely of God. It was definitely like a purposeful choice of mine. So yeah, overall it was like, it was great. And it was, it totally made me, I think it's totally a part of why I probably have a backbone now. And like socially I'm able to like be expressive and.
And not hate people.
Not hate people, which is important.
So what was it like coming off your mission?
It was right away. It was cool. I was so excited, obviously, to my family. I got pretty assimilated the right word? Like back into the ward. I remember my homecoming talk was like, and that was when we still had homecoming talks. I think it was a year or so after where they said like, let's not have any more like special Sunday party stuff. Like this isn't, let's keep it Christ centered, which was fine. But I think I was able to still, like, it was a dedicated sacrament meeting. And I just remember, like, everyone was blown away and that I had gone from, like, you know, loud, can't pass the sacrament, can't bless the sacrament, Tyler Glenn, to, like, this, like, you know, polished, tailored, eloquent, you know. And so seeing that reaction, too, and seeing my parents sort of in awe with that, because we were very communicative through my mission in letters and on holidays, but I think so. Seeing that was sort of seeing a mirror, like that was a confirmation, like this is right and this feels good. And the only time I felt a little intense was I think like in the High Council room and meeting with the stake president and after, and them really wanting me to be involved in the stake and do firesides and talks because they thought I was a pretty eloquent speaker. And that felt overwhelming. And I kind of feel like I made it clear that wasn't what I was interested in. And so I think I got the calling of like teaching the 10-year-olds. And it was pretty normal. Started going to singles ward eventually. And then a couple months into being home, I got a job at an Army Navy store, surplus store, and pretty much the whole client, all of the employees were LDS. So they were all kids I grew up with in the ward. And so that was really easy. I was surrounded with by that. But that was also the point where I decided that I was going to explore sexuality and maybe like go on a date or like see, but I was also very in private. So I remember going online and.
With men or women?
With men.
Okay, now wait a minute.
It's quick.
After that amazing mission experience, yeah. Your commitment to the church, you're a few months home after this amazing best 2 years of your life up to that point.
Yeah.
How do you go to thinking about men?
So
sexually.
So it wasn't sexually, but it was like, I know.
Romantically.
Romantically, yeah. I think it was like, okay, this feeling hasn't gone away. Like it was always a thing on my mission. Like, I knew that I was attracted to men. Like I said, I was able to maybe think of it as an emotional, or maybe turn it into like, oh, this is a friendship or this is a deep connection. But it was always something that like, was definitely something that I, you know, that I felt was like a part of me. And so I think I let myself, I let myself go on a date with a guy. And we went to like the local casino. There were restaurants there. It was like I was super nervous. And it was like a normal date. And it felt normal. It didn't feel seedy. It didn't feel shameful. So I started going on like on the sly with certain guys. And then I started to get more physical with them. And that's the first time I realized, oh crap. Like this is what kissing someone that I'm into is like. This is what, like, it totally, you know, obviously spoke to me. And
you're 22 at this point?
22, yeah. But it's super few and far between, and super that was the first time where I really think I started to compartmentalize, like, physically. Like, I was like, all right, I'm definitely keeping this in like a file. And I don't really know what this is about, but I definitely know that this isn't great.
Not something you talked to your bishop or parents about, or?
No, not for a while. We went, like, getting home too. It was like all about, like, I wanted to start neon trees again. So, and then Chris had moved to Provo to go to school. And so I was like crap. All right. So then I would play music locally, and I didn't love it. And I was like, no, I want to be in a band with Chris, and I want to do this. And like, this is what I've been, you know, dreaming about. And now's the time. And I remember telling, I felt like I had my mission president's like approval. And I felt like I had my parents' approval
to not get married.
Yeah. I felt like, all right, like, I'm going to do this. And I told my parents, I was like, I'm going to give it two full years at try. I'm not going to half-ass this. I'm going to really try to make this band thing happen. And I know it doesn't make sense, and I don't really know how it's going to happen, but I'm going to do this. And I said, if it's not working out, and if it's not continuing to show like it's like something's going to happen, then I'll go to college or something. So that was the thing. But he had moved to Provo, and I was like, we're in California. Like, why are you going to Utah? We're never going to be able to start a band in Utah. Like, are you crazy? like what's even going on there? And I remember feeling pretty like, all right, my life's not great here. I'm starting to feel like I'm sort of getting in a rut again. And I was like, and about 9 months after my mission, I called Chris up and I was like, hey, I want to move to Provo. Cause like you're out, clearly not coming back anytime soon. And I want to make this band.
Did he serve a mission?
Yeah. He had served. He's a little older than me. He's like my older brother.
So he had served before.
He went to Guatemala. Yeah. So he was down for, it was like October. I'd quit my job very dramatically. I left like a really long note. I didn't love my boss, so that was sort of part of it too. It felt like, and I remember leaving one lunch and just not coming back. And I remember my boss calling me and saying something like, if you don't pick up, I'm going to drain all your minutes. Cause that was back when like minutes mattered. I don't know if that's possible though. Can you like drain someone's minutes by like
on their voicemail,
leaving their voicemail?
I don't know.
She threatened. I don't know. Whatever. It was bizarre. So she called my parents, and I remember my parents picking me up, and they're like, my dad and I had a big talk, and he had concerns. And I was like, no, this is like, nothing bad is happening. I really feel like I need to go to Provo because nothing's happening here musically. I want to be in a band with Chris. And they gave me their blessing. So Chris came down one October with his truck, and I piled everything that I owned into the bed of his truck. It was sad because like on the 91 freeway driving up, we hadn't even left California yet. And like one of the crates of all my Bruce Springsteen memorabilia fell out onto the freeway.
Oh.
So I'm watching like like memorabilia that I had bought on eBay, like getting like demolished by traffic. And but it also kind of was like, all right, this is this wild ride and this is this beatnik adventure. And but it, you know, so I ended up in Provo, and a week later I was like, who do you know that plays music? And he had kind of been hanging out with some dudes that play music, and we all met up at a pizzeria in Salt Lake, the Pie, and ended up saying, let's do this. And we started band practice. And then a week later, we were at a billiards in Provo called Oz, and went in and we-
Well, was that Elaine?
No.
That original? Okay.
So the original lineup was five dudes in Provo.
Okay.
And we had a synth player, an electronic drummer. So he played an electronic kit. And then we had, I would play keyboards in the front sometimes. And then we had a bass player and a guitar player.
So you'd play keyboards by ear as well?
Yeah, it was just about sounds and what sounded cool. Yeah, so we walked into Oz one night. It was at billiards, and I guess we looked like a band. And the guy was like, are you the band playing tonight? Like the owner guy. I was like, no, but we are a band and we'll come play. And he's like, all right, how's November 8th? And I remember us moving. I moved to like October 15th or something to Provo. So it was like 2005. Like 3 weeks later, we had to play a show. So we had to have a set worth of material.
And was it a billiard hall?
It was a billiards hall that had like a loft upstairs that like they would probably like 70 or 80 people could fit up there.
Is it still there?
Oz is still there, but it's called something else.
Okay.
It changed like 6 or 7 times.
Okay.
And it might just be like a restaurant now. I have no idea. I should know more. But yeah, we played our first show there. And
so were they original? Were they covers?
They were like... I think we did a Radiohead song. That was the only song that was a cover. And then we did a couple of my songs that I had written. I think one off my mission that I had written.
These are rock songs?
They're pop rock songs. They're well crafted for at that time. And then eventually we had 7 or 8 songs, but people showed up. And that I was like, this is cool. Like 70 people came to see our first show. Like, this is great. Like 10 people, mostly family and friends, would come in California. This is awesome. So I felt at that point like, okay, Provo, maybe, you know, there's a college here, there's youth, there's other bands. Fallor had just been announced that it was opening. That was like the new venue in Provo. You know, it's been open for 10 years now. It's having its 10th anniversary this month. But so I felt like we could be a part of a scene. We could develop a sound. And just from that point on, we'd get booked at the venues. We'd get booked at venues up in Salt Lake, and yeah.
I thought I read that when you got off your mission, the Killers had already kind of hit.
They had,
and you were a little bit angry.
I was bummed. I was bummed because that was the sound that.
Had you known Brandon?
I hadn't known Brandon. No, I didn't meet Brandon or any of the Killers guys till a little later.
How did they develop a sound that you wanted to develop? Like,
oh,
was it just in the air?
Oh yeah. We had the same interest. I think I remember leaving on my mission. It was 2000, end of 2002, 2003. And that, the sound at the time, there were only a few underground indie bands. There was one band that was sort of breaking through called Hot Hot Heat that sounded sort of like The Cure, like dancier Cure. But that was like about the only, and then there's a band called The Faint that I love. There's a poster over there. But they were kind of like an electro clash synth influenced band.
So those meaning the Clash, like the British?
No.
Okay.
Electro clash was like a kind of an electronic music sound in the early aughts.
Okay.
But so there were bands brimming that used synths, brimming on the sort of the underground and the indie scene, but there weren't a lot that had bust through. And then, so obviously on my mission, like, I tried to listen every now and then, like I was in the grocery store in Target or, you know, on P days, like I remember having companions that had some secular music. They would put it on the car and I'd be like, we shouldn't be doing this, but keep it on. I want to hear that song. And so I tried to pay attention as much, but it was like, it obviously becomes impossible on your mission. You're so focused on that life. And so coming back from my mission, there were all these bands that sort of sounded like bands I wanted to sound like. So it wasn't like I wanted to sound like the Killers, but they had broken through, and there's a band called Interpol, and there's a band called Block Party. And so all these bands started to use dance rock in their music. And I was like, dang, dang, that was like the sound that we wanted to sound like. But then I was kind of like, okay, maybe since this music's cool, like, okay, you know, it kind of works. It's of the time. So it was okay. I think.
Did any of those bands come out of Provo?
I know that Brandon lived in Nephi for a little while growing up, but none of those bands came out of Provo. There was a band called The Used that came out of Orem, kind of when I was in high school, but they were more of a punk rock, emo, screamo group. But they were like a big band when they burst through from Utah County.
Okay.
But up until then, it was them basically were the big band that had broken through. So.
So The Used kind of gave you a sense that maybe someone, a band out of Provo could be big, right?
Yeah. I mean, they were a band I really liked in high school when I was getting into more like aggressive music, and they were kind of like a gateway band for that. So, but yeah, knowing that they were from Orem and that they rumored to have Mormon roots or raised Mormon or whatever, I was just like, yeah, cool. But, you know, and so moving to Provo, I knew that it was possible. And there was a band called Broke that was also had gotten signed, I think, the year that I moved to Provo as well. So like, there was definitely it was in the air that it was possible to make it a career and make it out of this area. So, and I really fell in love with living there. I had started to meet friends that like I still call friends to this day, and I loved playing here because I think what I loved is like, especially in Utah County, playing. Everyone was there to see the show and super focused on the music because there was no partying, you know, that atmosphere wasn't there. So it was like a rock show without the alcohol or the drugs. So everyone was just like super into it, you know, and I have friends in bands now that love to tour in Utah. It's their favorite crowds to play for because maybe it's, you know, a lot of our, the way we express ourselves at shows. I don't know, but that was definitely the energy, you know.
Music's in our veins, I think.
Yeah, maybe, yeah. Or like we don't get out our stuff in any other way, so we get really into live shows.
So you hear now about the music scene in Provo, but would you say you guys were kind of the start of that becoming a real bigger thing, or was it?
I would say we're part of it. I definitely wouldn't claim the whole thing. Because there were bands that started getting national attention, but not really like totally making it. I think we might have been the first band out of our class of bands around that era of Provo that really like got signed and made it to the next level, and then made a record and it was everywhere. But then beyond that, just like the success that Neon Trees had on an international level and having hits, that was crazy. That was like, but my whole thing was I just wanted to like be in a band and play shows, and I wanted the shows to get bigger. And that's really what I cared about at the time. So I would say like we were definitely a big part of like putting Provo on the map as far as like music and industry, knowing bands existed there and stuff like that.
So you started at that pool hall, and then how did it build?
We started playing the two local clubs there. There's Muse Music and Velour. And the owner of Velour, Corey Fox, took a chance on us and had us headline our first show at Velour there. And he usually is very like, he curates a lot of shows and like is very specific on like the styles and matching. And he just, he took a chance with us, and he had never seen us play before, but had us headline. And
was that like a few months or years from that first gig?
Oh, it was like a month.
Oh, wow.
Less, maybe less.
So you're headlining at Velour within a month of playing at that.
And it was like sold out. It was definitely like, and it's like a 350 cap club, but I think even back in the day we used to pack.
What does that mean? 350 cap.
Cap. Okay.
Attendance. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But I mean, that club back, at least back in the heyday when it was like really popular, I think it still is obviously, but he would shove like tons more people in there. There was definitely like fire safety hazards and stuff, but it was amazing. It was an amazing time.
And so are you furiously writing music at this point?
Yeah. Yeah. I never, once Neon Trees played its first show at Oz Billiards Hall, like I never looked back, and we just played. We'd play everywhere. We would play at any apartment complex. any BYU party. We didn't play a lot of those because we didn't want to be considered a BYU band. Like, we didn't mind appealing to anybody, but we wanted to, you know, appear to be a band that like had its own thing and established that. So we would play all sorts of anywhere we could. We used to get made fun of a lot for playing 4 or 5 shows a week because we would just play wherever. And then we realized, okay, maybe the attitude of like playing so much isn't great. It's helped us get better and it's helped us write more music, but like maybe it's not like we need to make these more of event shows so that we're like people are coming and we're selling it out. And then we started to focus more on that. But
an event show.
Yeah, just more like the concept is basically like play a little less and so that people are looking forward to it and you maybe have 2 months of promoting it. So like, it's guaranteed sell out. It feels like it's a special thing. It feels more like a regional band than, because a local band, I would have played anywhere, anytime. Like that was the whole spirit of the band at that time. So we won, we started winning battles of the bands locally and we would get attention up in Salt Lake, but Salt Lake and Provo were kind of like enemy scenes. So like, and I use that lightly, but we didn't consider Salt Lake to be a cool music scene. And they didn't consider Provo to be a cool music scene, but then Provo started to really kind of develop and have its vibe and sound and like really cool bands. And so we would come up here and sometimes occasionally play bars, but the shows were never great. So, you know, it wasn't like a focus. And then the band kind of broke up and we had to...
What year?
2007. We had just finished recording an EP,
the five guys,
an EP release show with 4 of them because one of the guys went AWOL and left and we never heard from him again, basically. And so we scrambled, we did our EP release show.
So that's just you guys finding a local recording studio and
recording
your own album.
We recorded it with like a guy named Wiz, who's a music teacher down at UVU in Orem. And it sounded good. I listen back to it now and I'm a little embarrassed by it just because I think the songs were good, but there was a quality recording was weird. And like I recorded so many different vocal takes. So it sounds like there's like 8 or 9 of me on. It was just like the approach was a little, it was our first time in a studio. So we got a little excited, but whatever. But it was cool to have something out. And, and we'd kind of become like one of the big bands in Provo, and that felt good. And, that was when I was like, okay, I want more. We need to get label attention. And we had met, a talent guy that sort of was in LA that was sort of known for like helping craft bands and getting them, publishing deals and getting their music heard. And that was very entertaining and a great thought we entertained. Like we were excited about that concept. So we brought it up to the band and half the bandmates weren't really into it at the time. And we ended up, me and Chris realizing that like-
They didn't want to go bigger?
They did, but I don't think they totally dug the idea of moving out to California. I don't think they really had it in them, the drive to like make a band happen. I think they wanted to be in a band that was successful and loved all that. But like, I think some of them thought like felt the rush of being like a local popular band and were like, why aren't we on MTV already? Or why aren't we on the radio? And it was, you know, and I might be talking out of turn, but I really, that's like the vibe and that's the sort of way they presented themselves. So like, I knew there was a lot of work to be done. And me and Chris both really were hardworking and like started booking regional tours and spending all of our money. Like Chris went bankrupt, ended up living in the tour bus that we bought. And, you know, we bought an old shuttle, an airport shuttle bus and turned it into like a tour bus. It looked cool, but it like rode real janky and like was not meant to like be taken on a regional tour, but we did it. And that was just fun though. And we loved it and we didn't mind that we were like sick and hungry and starving, because that was like part of the dream. Like let's just get in and play shows and make
it happen. So you were hungry.
Yeah. So we I mean, there's a funny story I can get to you with that, but like, basically half the band felt like dead weight. So we kind of, had a dramatic parting of ways. And then we were still booked for this local festival called Sago. And it was kind of like a music festival down in Provo. And it was really cool. And we were like, we have a set to play. We should probably still play it. So I remember calling Brandon Campbell, our bass player now in Neon Trees. And Chris was dating Elaine Bradley at the time, who's our drummer. And Chris and Elaine kind of had the idea, like, let's get Tyler into the idea of you joining the band because you're a great drummer. And she played in other bands that were really successful as well. And sometimes our bands would play shows together. But I just, now this is, may seem sexist, and it's absolutely not, because I'm not a sexist person, but I just never saw a girl in Neon Trees. Like, to me, it was like I'm big into aesthetic, and it just didn't, I always felt like people would think, oh, we have the token girl player. And it was probably a rude, you know, fear of mine. It probably wasn't appropriate, but like, I just, you know, I just didn't think a girl drummer fit in Neon Trees. That wasn't the vibe of Neon Trees, whatever vibe I thought I was going for, whatever. But she like, she would say even to you that she like weaseled her way in. She knew she wanted to be in that band, in this band. So
you think she dated Chris to get in the band?
I don't know. Cause they only dated for like 6 months.
Elaine, if you're watching, I want to know the answer to that question.
I know, right? Yeah.
Did you really like Chris?
She liked Chris. I think Chris, that was right around the time Chris was kind of going through like his sort of faith crisis at the time. Slowly, I think it was the early start. Because his, and I don't want to speak to Chris's experience more than I know or can, but like, I definitely remember like, it was around Prop 8. We had moved back to Marietta as a band.
That's near?
Near Temecula.
Temecula, yeah.
We wanted to be as close to LA as possible, but we were like dirt poor. And so I moved back into my parents' house. And Chris moved into his parents' house around the corner. And so did the rest of the band. And so we were kind of like living at our parents' house again.
Wait, so Elaine moved?
Elaine moved and Brandon.
And Brandon.
But Brandon had two kids and a wife in Provo. So he would like go out for 2 weeks, go back for a week, go out for 2 weeks. So it was like, but everyone was super committed. And it was amazing. And we all really wanted the band to happen. So all we did was write songs, song after song a day. I think we wrote at least two songs a day, practiced for 8 hours every day. That's all we did.
Where did you practice?
At Chris's parents' house.
Like in the garage?
It was very like high school band, but we were like all in our like mid to late 20s.
In the garage or basement?
No, there was like a room upstairs, and we would put mattresses up against the windows so that like the neighbors wouldn't be mad. And we would only be able to, so we would like maybe practice like from noon, from 1 to 8 or noon to 8 to like, so that we were keeping, you know, good neighborly hours. And
Chris's parents were cool with that.
They were cool. I think at the time they might've had another house that they were living at full time. So I think that the house Chris grew up in that their parents still owned became sort of like the kid's house, you know. It was still like owned and ran by their parents.
How do you practice for 8 hours a day?
That's the exhilarating part about this group and what I've loved. And maybe they're not like maybe at the end of the day, they're not my best friends, but I think of them as family, obviously. But like, I just think we all were on the same page of like devotion and love for music. We just loved it so much.
It's about the music.
It was completely about the music. It had nothing to do with friendship, because I had known Chris for years at that point, but we still weren't very like close friends. I feel like I'm finally closer to him after.
That seems, it's like between takes and like the nights, and you're talking about your life, you'd think.
Oh, and I feel like that was the beginnings of friendships that I feel like I'll have for a long time. But you know, I think Brandon and I definitely became really, really, really close in that process.
But you're also saying that you can go years spending all day with somebody for years, yeah, and not really necessarily
know them,
go deeper.
Yeah. Yeah. And I don't know if that was because we were all in, you know, I could elaborate, and I'll elaborate a little without, because I don't want to like speak to their experience, but what I could gauge is we were all in different places. We were all Mormon, and we were all raised Mormon and currently Mormon, but we were all in different stages of our faith, I think. I used moving back to my parents' house as almost like a restart, because I had been dating a girl for about 2 years, solidly dating her. And, you know, I'd met their parents. I remember getting a blessing from her dad. It became a real thing. And I think we even thought we would get married.
This is while you're in Provo.
While I was in Provo.
You're dating a girl.
Before we moved to California. That kind of fizzled out because I think she realized, and she broke up with me in a half page note. And at the time I was super bummed out. I was like, I think I was more bummed out because I was like, this was her. I had found her. I think I would have made it work. But I mean, looking back, I was a terrible boyfriend because I was so like on edge all the time and probably not as authentic as I could have been. And she was completely right. I remember her telling me I was never going to love her the way she needed to be loved. And at the time I was like, that's dramatic and that's intense and you don't know that. But now looking back, so.
Did you think of yourself as being attracted to her?
Yeah, I think she fit. You know, what's funny is I dated really hot girls, which is dumb because I almost used it as like it looks the part.
Like a beard, is that what they say?
A beard or whatever. Yeah, it looked.
Is that an offensive term?
I don't know. Okay. I don't know. Not to me, but
okay.
Maybe.
Okay.
Maybe to somebody. it's terrible.
But you weren't thinking it. Were you thinking of it that way as a cover or not?
Maybe subconsciously, I think. But I also in my heart felt like I could have made it work at that moment.
You loved her. You loved her.
I loved her. Yeah, I loved her. But again, I think and I've said this before, but like, I think it was the love that I knew, or like what I thought the concept of love was at the time. And I look back at that, and that was very selfish on my part. And I was actually probably, I'm glad it worked out the way she did. That she ended up breaking up with me. That was really bold of her, because I probably would have never broken up with her and it would have gotten weird. But so right after that was about the time when the band was going through its lineup changes, and we were considering moving to California, but we hadn't. And I started, that's when I
started. You said you got a blessing. Did I interrupt you about the blessing?
I don't think you did. Okay. It was, I just was using that as an example of like, I'd gotten close to her family. Her dad had given me a blessing when I think I was having a tough time. I think a lot of the tough time had to do with like what was going on inside, but I didn't obviously express that. And then I started, after that relationship ended, I was like, all right, well, I'm going to try this guy thing again. And that's when it got really toxic and bad, because I started to do it on the sly.
In Provo or LA?
This was in Provo, like right before we moved to California. And that's when I, you know, I'll admit it. It was Craigslist was a site used to find, you know,
hookups.
Other men. Yeah. And the eye-opening part of it for me was as how many Mormon men, closeted Mormon men there were. It felt like so many in that area. And
married men.
I think so.
Returned missionaries.
Yeah. And it became a very dark time in my life where I was compartmentalizing, where I felt like I was physically turning a switch on and off, where I felt like I was sort of becoming two people. I would be at my friend's house and then, you know, use their computer. It was back when I didn't even have my own computer at the time. And I would, you know, find a guy and we'd, you know, meet on a corner in Provo or meet at a park and go for a drive and talk. And then, you know, something would probably happen. And then I would go home and it almost was like, I just filed it away, turned it off. And so that was really bad. And it started catching up with me. I was like, this is bad. I'm embarrassed. I'm ashamed.
What does it do to you to compartmentalize like that? like, psychologically, mental health wise?
Oh, it's the worst. It's so unhealthy. To me, it felt, I guess I'll get into it. Like, to me, it was weird because I was still going to church, but that was also a time where I wasn't. And I remember taking my garments off and stopped wearing them because I felt that I was in the wrong, and I totally thought the temple was a sacred place, and I totally thought those covenants were sacred. But I think me experimenting in a way was, again, a part of survival. Like, I have to explore this. I don't know how it's coming out in other ways. You know, I'm not happy. So I remember taking my garments off, and a lot of concern came my way, and my parents weren't sure what I was doing, and I didn't really address it much. And I was always nervous I was always wearing things that maybe looked like I still had them on. Like, it was definitely like a thing where it became like, I want to still present because I know it's important, and I felt like I was letting people down in a way. But compartmentalizing is, I think I felt like I kind of had developed, I don't know, like, there were times where I thought, like, I'm going to go crazy one day, and I'm going to snap, or I'm going to, there were even times where I considered maybe I was put on the earth. Maybe I was one of, Lucifer's people. Like, maybe this was my purpose to sort of, you know, go through this experience in that way. Like, I sincerely believed that maybe I had been overtaken by something that I couldn't control
anymore. You mean put on the earth to be the cautionary tale of what not to become?
Right. But also I thought for a little while that I was perhaps in the premortal existence, like, not like some sort of spirit had taken control of me at some point. I don't know. I thought it got to a point where I felt very unworthy and very like this is all this, there must be a reason why I feel all this contention and why I'm forced to make these choices. Like, never considering that being gay is an option or that's a lifestyle that I actually probably should leave because that's who I am.
Yeah, because you're believing the church is true and acting out in a way that isn't consistent.
Yeah, it was really, really bad. So moving to California, you know, it's weird to talk about all this out loud because I feel like these are conversations I've had with myself. You know,
you've never really, this is stuff you haven't talked about much with people?
Not really. Not on this elaborated. Moving to California though, like, was, I felt like a restart. I was moving back to my parents' house. It felt like a safe space. I had never experimented with sexuality in California at that time, except for like once or twice after my mission. It felt like I could like recharge, restart, go back to a ward where I knew people. The bishop of the singles ward at that time was one of my seminary teachers as a high schooler. So like, for me, it felt like, ah, cool. And I was surrounded by, I had a lot more friends in Marietta still at that time. So it was like, cool, I'm going back to my roots. I'm going back to, you know, a safe space. I'll be living with my parents, you know.
To try and retrench in the gospel.
Retrench in the gospel, get active. Yeah, absolutely, get active again. Go to church with my bandmates. They were all LDS, even though we're all in different places. And I also felt like it was like, I was with my parents, and there was, their home had the spirit, and I just felt like it was a safe space to like, to be again. And that, I loved that. But then I kind of found, you know, you find out like, you know, Elaine's going through something at this point with her faith. And so she's hiding the fact that she's kind of secretly partying, and Brandon's sort of secretly partying, And Chris is sort of considering if the church is true or not, but none of us are like addressing that issue because I think we're all afraid of each other. So the mind blowing part of it, we were all putting up appearances in a way.
For each other.
For each other.
Because not just for the world, but for each other.
Because I think we really loved the idea of us being a rock band that could defy the like, yeah, we're Mormon, but like I loved that I could say I was Mormon with like weird hair and cool clothes. And like that for me was a badge of honor, like, you know, in a way. And I think that was for a lot of the band. I think we, you know, when we loved our experiences. Chris or Brandon was also a convert, and so he had that, like, he knew that the church had changed his life and he served a mission. And so we all had such fondness and belief in the gospel that that we all kind of, I think we were just putting up appearances in a way at that time. And then we ended up getting a lot of earlier attention from stuff in LA. I started playing more shows.
Is that hard to break into the LA music scene?
Yeah, like, it's awful.
Being in Provo?
It's awful. We missed Provo. But we needed to be there to like be close to like industry connections and to network. So we would drive up to LA every week and rent a studio and play all of our new songs for this guy. And this guy ended up being our first manager. That went south, but I'm actually legally not allowed to talk about that. So whatever, we won't talk about that. But anyway, it led us back to like, we always wanted to move back to Provo because I felt we liked the idea that we started there. We liked being from there. We didn't really like the LA scene because it really wasn't a scene. It was just like this big expanse of like everyone trying.
How long were you there?
Probably a year in Murrieta.
And just performing at local clubs and...
Performing at local clubs, doing as many shows as you can, performing for this talent guy. He ended up getting us a publishing deal. It was a really bad deal, but we took whatever we could get at the time.
Meaning songs you wrote, other people could record or what?
No, songs for us. It was basically he was developing us. And so he was like, you need to write as many... I learned a lot from this guy, to be honest. Like, he got me listening to artists that I always loved, but always considered like, oh, they're just like, they're pop hits or these. But I was like, wait, no, like U2 is a band I loved, or Stevie Wonder is this artist I loved. He's viable. Like, so, and he got us really listening to music in that way, like looking at arrangements and like looking at song structure and learning how to write songs. But
a publishing deal is not a record deal.
It's not a record deal.
What does it mean?
For us, it was if we supplied enough music that they could use for placements. Like, it was our original music, and it would be placed under Neon Trees. But it was kind of like it's almost like a stepping stone to a record deal.
Do they use them in commercials? Do they?
They never did, but that was like the hope. And if we supplied music for this publishing company, then we would get, you know, an advance. Every so often. So it was paying for stuff. It was the first money we'd ever seen. Looking back, it was like no money, but for
us. You didn't
us,
make money in Provo?
We would make it, but it was like just going back in the band fund, like paying for gas and, you know, paying back Chris for like all the money that he'd gone into bankrupt, like.
On his credit cards, just maxing
stuff
out. Full on
chat filed, you know, living. That was a dark time for him just because he was like, I'm, you know, approaching 30 or whatever. He might've been 30 at that point, and he's living back at his parents' house and bankrupt. Like, that wasn't great. But we were already like a few years into the band. So it definitely didn't look hopeful, but every now and then little things would happen. And then we got a call. We did a regional tour and we ended up playing in Vegas. And Brandon Campbell, our bass player, grew up with Ronnie Vannucci, the drummer for the Killers. And they were always buds, but and Brandon would always show like projects he was involved in or bands he was involved in, but he would never, but Ronnie was always like pretty transparent, like, yeah, that's okay. That, or maybe that has potential. But like when he saw us play, he saw us play when we had a stop in Vegas, when we played for like 10 people. But he saw us play and we had been known, didn't matter the size of the crowd. Like we'd always just given our all, and even smaller crowds got us to go even even that much more. And he just saw this potential in us, and a month later invited us to open shows for the Killers. And like, that Killers were the biggest American band at the time.
The biggest American band?
They were the biggest American band at the time. Like, absolutely.
Wow.
It, like, rock band, for sure. Like, it was at the height of their career, you know? It was
what year about?
It was right before they put their third record out, so 2008. It was like their second record had exploded when we were young. It was like the big, that was the biggest, you know, they were a massive rock band, you know.
And you're opening for them?
And we're opening for them. It's just a couple select dates, you know. I think a lot of people confuse it, like we had toured with them, but it was just a few dates. But like those two dates basically got us the attention we needed. Like Universal, you know, A&R guy from Universal Music and Island Records were at those shows because that was the label that the Killers were signed to. And they saw us play. And after the San Francisco date, the second show we played with the Killers, we had a meeting with David Massey, who's the president. He's a legend in the music industry, but he's the president of Island Records. It was called Mercury Records at the time. And, you know, they basically hinted at signing us. And then a month later, the A&R guy, Evan Lipschitz, came out to Logan to see us play at this tiny, I don't even think it's around anymore. There was this tiny hall, probably could fit 50 people in it. We played played a set. He took us out for dinner at Squatters Music Pub and gave us a contract, and we signed it.
Squatters here in Salt Lake?
Squatters Pub,
right,
yeah.
Right,
pub.
A block away?
Block away or whatever, yeah. That's where we signed to Mercury Island Records and started making our album. And so
that was 2008, 2009?
2008, and then 2009, we started working on our first record.
How many songs do you think you'd written by that point?
Oh, like
dozens, hundreds, like?
Less than 100, but definitely like upwards of almost 100.
Okay.
Yeah, if that makes sense. But, and so we thought we had a record. We were like, oh, we have like 5 records done. Because we always thought everything we wrote was quality. And maybe we were biased. And I look back and I see the charm in a lot of those, but I totally see like, okay, you know, we were still figuring out stuff.
You didn't bring any of those forward?
There's a bunch of
signed?
Bunch of songs on the first on our first album that that were songs we used to play in Provo even.
So Animal?
Animal was a song that sort of started, pretty much shaped the sound of the band. Because before we were a little darker and dancier, and Animal was a song I wrote with my friend who became our producer, and now he's one of my best friends, and I've done all my albums with him, but his name's Tim Pagnotta, but we wrote Animal together, and that just, it brought a soulfulness out of my voice that I wasn't using in Neon Trees at the time, and Emilio was like, oh, I love this. So then we wrote a few other songs in that vein. And there's a song called Sins of My Youth that we used to write, or that I wrote back in the Provo days that we used to play, that opens the first album. And so like mentally at that time, like I was so entrenched in making a band happen that I didn't even, like my libido was turned off. But at the same time, I tried dating a girl again back in Provo, and she had been kind of a roommate. I was living with a couple that had just gotten married, and they had left the church, and I was living with them, and I always felt bad. I always kind of felt bad for them. I was like, man, like you guys seem happy, but like, I don't know why you're, like, she was just about to graduate from BYU and considering not graduating and just moving in with her boyfriend who became her husband and things like that, where it was like, I just felt bad that they were making those choices, but I liked them. And, you know, and I ended up, you know, forming this relationship with this girl and trying to make it work. But it's funny, I would always use like the law of chastity as an excuse to not do anything physical with her. And she would always kind of push like, but she's like, I at least like to know that there was an option that we would do that. And I was always like,
no. What do you mean an option?
That was something she said to me. Like she, I think I put off a vibe like I probably wasn't attracted to her. I probably wasn't keeping up enough of appearance at that point. And so, yeah, I remember her telling me that, I remember specifically, we were down in my room, and I think she wanted to at least get to a point where it wasn't crossing any lines, but I was just any excuse I could think of, but I was definitely I'm liking thinking about going back to church more regularly. And, I think, and now I look at that as
saying you want to be temple worthy.
Yeah. And I was using that as an excuse all the while. I was pretty much all right, almost at the point where I was going to not ever date women again. And just and then when the band broke and, took off, and that first record came as a surprise, and Animal was our first song, and it was a hit, and that took us into a world that it was a roller coaster. And so from that point on, only in the last year has it mellowed out where I'm at least home to put up some stuff on my walls, but it just overtook the whole everything I did. So, and it was awesome. I was finally I can it was I could hide in the band. I could create this image of this guy on stage. It was a safe space because no one was partying on the bus, but if they were doing it in secret, which I found out later that was all happening. But it was we were all
so you guys wouldn't party together
if anyone partied. No, that was what was weird. It was I would get mad. When I would see other people partying, I would be I'd get mad at them. And I think maybe that was because I knew the pain I felt. And I was it was always better. You shouldn't be doing that. Even though I was doing my own things that were going against. It was very conflicting. And I think going back to the compartmentalizing aspect of my life.
Thank you for joining us today on Mormon Stories Podcast. To discuss this podcast with others, please check us out at mormonstories.org. To join one of our 80-plus support communities across the globe, click on the Support Communities tab at mormonstories.org. To keep this podcast alive, please consider a tax-deductible donation today by becoming a monthly subscriber at mormonstories.org. Audio and video for this podcast were provided by Richard Holdman. A big thanks to the Saber Rattlers for providing the music for today's episode. The Mormon Stories logo was generously donated by StudioCase.com.
Come, come, ye saints, no toil nor labor fear, but with joy.